This isn't the image of modern living we're used to seeing. On Great Barrier Island, just off the New Zealand mainland, a remote community lives entirely off the grid. These homes are not connected to mains or utilities. Out here, it's all about self-sufficiency.
Go for walks and it will be charging your phone while you walk.
I love that. That's fantastic.
At the island's only sports club, I've arrived in time for what's becoming a pretty popular event here.
So about twice a year, this island runs an off-grid festival for a whole week, and pretty much the entire community gets involved. It's a chance for locals to share tips and for the uninitiated like me to kind of learn all the different off-grid scenarios that exist on the island.
Everyone who lives here has found creative ways to grow their food, source water, power their homes and their cars.
Evie's up there, up here.
I've been Evie for the last 4 years.
And sometimes she's bringing it to the pub and charging there.
That was my only reason for being at the pub.
And recently, this is attracting new arrivals.
And what about you guys? Where are you from?
I'm from Germany.
I'm from the UK.
We sailed from Auckland to Great Barrier.
The title just said, like, experience sustainable living on an off-grid island. I was like, what? That's so cool.
For years, this off-grid community has sat at around 900 people. But since the pandemic hit, the local council estimates it's jumped by around 30%.
Did you make this bread?
Made this artisan sourdough, started 2 days ago.
Is this something you've just recently got into?
Yep, COVID-19.
So we went into lockdown here in New Zealand and we'd heard about this place and so we thought we'd come out here to check it out. And then 1 year on, we're still here.
So are you planning on staying long term here?
We are. We're trying to find some land to buy actually. It's kind of a good place to be right now in the current context of the world.
In the last year, Great Barrier Island's medical centre has registered around 150 new permanent settlers. But there's been an even bigger upsurge in holidaymakers. So what happens when an off-grid utopia becomes inundated?
I've heard that this clean green getaway is quickly becoming a victim of its own serene popularity, and I'm here to find out why.
To get a sense of what off-grid living looks like out here, the next day, I join a property tour as part of the festival.
So why are you on this tour today?
just totally to be nosy.
What are you hoping to get out of it?
Same thing, nosy, I suppose.
A lot of nosy individuals in here today.
The best way to learn is to see what people do and particularly sometimes see what problems they've had.
With the arrival of new settlers, the island is experiencing a housing and construction boom. And I've heard there've been some big changes when it comes to the nature of off-grid living here.
So welcome, this is this area of the barriers called Windy Hill, and I have been a landowner here since I was 19 years old. So I'm just gonna quickly run you through the basics of my power, water, and septic, the grunty bits. Okay.
Excellent.
Like most homes here, Judy's place is powered entirely by the sun, with battery storage and a generator for backup.
So there's 8 6-volt batteries in there, and I have an 8.6 kVA generator. I've got a solar hot water system, and then I've got 8 panels all together, about 2.7 kilowatts. Now to run a little 3-bedroom home and a sleep out, that's enough.
Designed by an architect, every part of this house is extraordinary.
So this is the eastern seaboard. You've got Midlands, Kaitauke, Palmers. You've got Hirakamata, which is the highest peak.
Water comes from rainwater tanks and a nearby spring. Toilet waste becomes compost, and heat is made the old-fashioned way.
So I've got a wood burner in my little lounge area, and I've got a really good grunty wood stove in my kitchen.
But Judy is admittedly wealthy. She owns several investment properties and has spared no expense.
Because it's got huge big poles, because it's massively high off the ground. From the bottom corner to the top, it's 14 metres of scaffolding. So actually we chop it in See, you can have really nice off-the-grid places. I think that whole notion that off-the-grid places used to be a bit rumpty is long gone.
If you don't mind my asking, how much do you think you've invested in this place to date?
Ha! I don't think I should say. You're talking about a million
ballpark
bucks.
Ballpark figure, really?
Yeah.
A million bucks.
Yeah.
So, what did everybody think of that place?
It was beautiful. Stunningly beautiful.
Barrier house.
No, not at all.
And what is the standard Great Barrier House?
Probably a little bit smaller. Not as much glass.
Yeah, it was beautiful, but very expensive.
Yeah.
You know, when she said, oh, helicopter in when you've still got a driveway.
So on to the next one.
Got the driver? Yep.
27 years and a lot of money later, Judy's created an off-grid utopia. And it's this luxury new form of off-grid living that's attracting wealthy holidaymakers. It's extremely stylish for off-grid living.
I hate the word minimal, but it kind of is. People get kind of, they think somehow that they can do this, but I think that it would cost you plenty.
Do you think this place is representative of most houses on the island in Great Barrier?
Probably not. A lot of people really hate it,
yeah.
Which is kind of curious, but you know, I don't really care.
Yeah. This is a pretty sophisticated form of off-grid living. It makes it look glamorous, green and easy, but I have to wonder how attainable this really is for the residents who actually live here full time. Originally settled by Maori explorers and European farmers, the first arrivals to Great Barrier were far from wealthy. Even today, the island remains the poorest area in the Auckland region. The average income of those who live here full-time is only around $20,000. For these long-term locals, off-grid living looks very different.
Pretty much the new millionaire beach. The house here has been going for like 3 years. This one's been being built and it's, you know, only halfway there.
What do you think of these properties?
Oh, look, personally, I'd rather see it be a farm. But they're big developments for people that essentially probably won't be spending a lot of time here.
yeah, cool. Patrick O'Shea belongs to one of the Barrier's heritage farming families. They've been here for generations.
This is the farm up here.
This is your farm?
Yeah, yep. So this is the top of the Arwen Valley.
All this around us is
yeah,
is
left
your
and
land.
Right, that's it. Lots of land, lots of grass. High water table and it's still fairly warm, so we're doing well. The driveway is getting a little bit wet.
Unlike new arrivals, Patrick's rich in land but poor in income. There she is. So he's found a pretty unique way to build his house. Is this your place over here?
Yeah, this is my little setup over here.
Looks great! Built entirely from recycled materials, every part of his house, he's had to wait for others to discard.
Solar panels, freaking satellite internet, and lights, and it's good to go.
And you got a garden out back.
Yeah, so this is the original attempt at a garden. This went all spring, and then these are yakon, South American sort of tuber. That's like literally my shower.
It's low carbon living and incredibly resourceful. Where does the water come
quickly
from?
Just out there, spout up in the tree there.
It hooked up to?
Gas boil and a small
little water pump.
Yes.
Oh my god. Even his water is sourced by tapping into a nearby creek.
Our supply comes from like over the hill, out of a little tributary. It's a good kilometre from here. Just to get enough fall, to get your pressure. So everything's gravity pressure, no electric pumps, which really helps. So out this way, we've got the bath, as you can see, some windows behind you, there's a sink over there. And then eventually I'm gonna pretty much have enough stuff to initiate it, build the bathroom.
For Patrick, living off-grid is anything but convenient. It's half luck and a lot of patience.
That used to be the police car, then he rolled it.
But it's also an act of resistance. His dream is to turn this junk into low-cost housing for locals being priced out of the market.
So where'd this come from?
Yes, someone ended up having to drop this off at the Claris landfill, so it had pretty much reached its end of life. I was about to go in the scrap pile and I had to save it. So it's gonna have a whole new lease on life again.
Can I go inside?
Yeah, take a step in there. Yeah, we'll put a bed in there and a little set of drawers and a little desk there, and someone will be happy as with that.
This feels like old school Great Barrier living off grid.
Yeah, well, essentially this is how you did it, because you weren't investing in a home, you'd bought your $20,000 property, and you loaded up a bus with everything you thought you needed and started the journey. And yeah, as long as you dry, that was the start of a house for most people.
I can't imagine many of the newcomers to this island doing this.
Yeah, and that is the reality, and somewhat the sad thing, where you're losing a bit of the identity of the island. Like, that was how people were living. They were living out of necessity and lifestyle. Whereas now it's more convenience.
Carrying the torch, Patrick. I love it.
Yeah.
Does it feel like that?
Yeah, personally, I feel like I do have to stand up for the old ways, you know, keep a bit of reality in there. And yeah, don't succumb to the modern views too quickly, for sure. Yeah, let's have a good look.
Like many long-term residents, reusing and recycling is all Patrick knows. But this isn't the case for many newcomers, and it's having some big impacts for the island's green status.
Good as they should be, really, you know. They throw out stuff that should be recycled and that.
Leave the yard, gentlemen.
But we can't sort it all out, we've just got to do our job.
Across the island, waste is piling up. And it's having enormous knock-on effects at the community's only landfill.
So yeah, this is a horrific side to island waste. Everybody's waste comes here, and this is what we haven't diverted from landfill, and it ends up here in a big pile.
Oh my goodness.
Exactly, yeah, oh my goodness.
What do you think when you look at this?
You just think we're a wasteful society. That's what you think.
Brett O'Reilly recently took over management of the tip and says it's now the biggest issue the island faces.
So this is the only landfill site on the island,
correct?
Right?
Yeah.
And it's almost full.
It's almost full. Scary.
Tell me about that, because that's a big problem.
It is a big problem. So, the plan at this stage is for everything to be shipped off island and to go to town. So exactly how that happens is still getting worked on.
Before the pandemic, the landfill wasn't expected to fill up until 2027. But now, Brett says it's on track to happen much sooner.
My feeling is that there's a decrease sort of per population, but there's an increase with more people coming to the island and a different type of person. So as you get sort of a person that's used to living in the city, or where they don't see the waste, or they don't live so frugally, whereas they create more waste than the people that have been here for a long time and used to making the most of everything they have. So yeah, it certainly changes the dynamic and the type of waste we get.
Shipping waste off the island could impact the barrier's green off-grid status, threatening the very idea that made it attractive to those moving here in the first place. locals are now desperate to divert waste.
There comes someone.
And the jewel in the crown of their plan is this place.
Where are we, Layla? What's this place?
This is Anamata. It is our reuse recycle store. We get donations and we also are allowed to like take stuff out of landfill, and we have to just show how much diversion we keep from landfill. And it's all about trying to get that into people's minds now so that further down the track it's not such a big scary thing when the dump does close.
Being off-grid and cut off from the mainland inflates the cost of everyday goods and supplies on the island. So on the barrier, this is basically Bunnings.
We've constantly got people in here at the moment, and I feel like we're like the warehouse of barrier or something, you know, because they don't have shops and stuff. So
people will come here first as first port of call, yeah, to kind of buy what they need.
Absolutely. Before they order it from town or before they go to one of the shops over here, they'll come here first. So this is the kids' room. This is sort of the man's room. We call it the renovation station.
Someone's in there now.
Yeah.
What you looking for?
Don't know. It's a place where you don't come with preconceptions.
You want some money, honey?
Is that for shoes? Perfect. Thank you, Margaret. Okay.
Did you pick those shoes up?
From there.
They fit perfect.
And they match your top, to be fair.
But shoes I took off, I bought here too.
Oh, did you? And so this is our big shed.
The tip shop is in many ways the true off-grid spirit. Ingenious, creative, and a little bit mad.
We made the barrier hair dryer. They put it on your arm like this, hold up here. And this is the barrier hair dryer. No power required. It's off the grid living.
Out the back, I'm not surprised to find the person behind many of the tip's inventions is Patrick.
Hello, Mr. Patrick.
Mr. O'Shea.
Employed as the resident repairman, he can fix pretty much anything.
They're parts mowers, essentially. You get enough and then another one will come in the same model, and generally you can piece them together, get something to go. Same with the bikes. There is an amazing amount of bikes that come through.
I'll try to look at like the positive side of you know, a different demographic of people living here, not essentially poor and having to rely on their own self-sufficiency. The trickle-down effect is that we end up with a lot of good stuff here. Sometimes we're only spending half an hour, you know, a few fuel lines on a lawnmower, accelerator cable, something as simple as that, and then like a local can buy that for like $40, $50 and have a new bit of gear, basically.
Patrick's trying to look at the positives, but new arrivals to Great Barrier are an enormous catch-22. More people means more dollars and jobs. But it also means greater numbers, relying on the island's finite natural resources.
For us as Māori, we're very concerned about our environment. There's five things that are very important to us. One is our water, one is our airspace, and the other one is our foreshore and our moana, which is the sea. And it's a surviving force just in that, and if we don't look after it, then where are we going to end up? We're very concerned about it.
Hi,
Opo.
Hi.
How's it going?
Nice to meet you.
And Opo Nawaka is a Māori elder.
Hi, Kelly.
Lovely to meet you. Kia ora. Mm-hmm. So where are we?
We're in a place called Kawa on Mount Māori Reservation land. It's a marae. It's the Kawa marae. And welcome.
Deeply connected with the land, Opo says he's witnessing significant changes to the natural environment.
The water situation is under pressure. Yeah. Our streams are drying up and the island's getting more populated. Where's the water coming from, you know? I know they're trucking it from some of the main big streams, but they can't keep doing that. Some way or somehow, they have to think up of something that's gonna help the population that is here and maybe in the future.
With no mains on the island, many must source water directly from natural creeks and streams. But Opo says climate change is seeing less rain here.
Are the streams drying up?
They are, yeah. Yeah, they're drying up. And some streams, they're drying up during the summer and slowly come back during the winter, but every year is getting worse.
What do you think needs to change right now in order for this island to be sustainable long term?
I think in some cases we may need to slow down a little bit, you know, and until certain things are put in place. Yeah, it's funny, eh? This place used to have a lot of shellfish here. If we do a bit of thinking about the future, we should be fine.
It's not difficult to see the problem Opo is talking about. Back in town, I visit a creek in one of the most populated settlements on the island.
So we've just ducked off one of the roads here. All around here, the catchment feeds this creek, and all through it are pipes. Every one of these pipes is fueling water to the homes around here, supplying their showers, their bathrooms, their kitchens. And I guess the problem here is twofold. As climate change takes hold, there's less and less water supplying this catchment area, but more and more people are moving here. You just got to imagine how long it can last. I mean, look at this. This is absolutely crazy. There are pipes just running in every single direction. And some are even in the trees. And they just go all the way down. With cracks appearing in the eco-friendly image of off-grid living, I'm left wondering whether it's all truly viable. I've been told there's only one person on the island who can give it to me straight. So I'm down here at Fitzroy Wharf and I've arranged to meet somebody who's lived here since the 1950s. He lives on one of the most remote parts of this island and apparently he's a little bit of a character, so I'm not entirely sure what to expect. How are you doing?
Calista, is it?
Calista, nice
Calista,
to meet you,
Calista anyway. Yeah, yeah, yeah. How are you?
I'm good, I'm very good. I was expecting a bigger boat.
No, we're all poor here.
Sven Stellan has lived off-grid for 64 years.
Yeah.
And the only way to reach his place is by boat.
I don't live here because of the so-called environmental eco-friendly. I live here because it's my home. Is it eco-friendly? Probably yes and probably no. But on the effect of living out here as a human being, I still disturb the environment one way or the other.
Out here, Sven's been forced to make a living however he can. It's hardly glamorous and kind of bizarre.
Now what we're pouring in here today is waste oil. This is the fuel that we use to actually heat the water to actually extract the money from the chemical oil.
He makes money extracting therapeutic oils from the island's native manuka trees.
It feels like Willy Wonka's chocolate factory.
Yeah, well, that's except... right, exactly.
But it's the size of Sven's property that's truly staggering.
I'm going to give you guys some incredible views that right. You'll be going, fuck. Yeah, right, let's do it then. Let's get our asses into gear.
A long, skinny peninsula reaching out to the horizon. It's almost 2,000 acres that's completely off-grid and all his own.
What do you think of the view up here?
The view? It's not a bad view. That's all right. Yeah, we've got better views than this.
Is that your land too?
Yeah.
That's unbelievable.
Out here, Sven is cut off from society, and that's how he likes it.
There are very few places like this in New Zealand left now that are unspoilt and undeveloped. That's how screwed we are as a society. It's a shame. It's an indictment upon who we are as a species, really, unfortunately. As soon as you put human beings somewhere in considerable numbers, it changes the whole dimension of everything. Even though we're natural, we're just too many of us. Just a plague in many ways.
Even though Sven's tried to get away from civilization, he hasn't escaped its problems. Before I leave, he shows me his greatest dilemma.
Here you go. So there's the problem.
That says it all.
Humanity.
But you're out here living as off-grid as you could.
Yep. And we still
and
have
shit. And you still have this.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So there's no such thing as a carbon neutral footprint of humanity. That's just a ruse and a marketing ploy and total bullshit. If you want to get away from that, you want to be truly, like I said, organic, effectively go and hang yourself on the fucking tree, or go and live in the cave. And people may think I'm some sort of asshole, but all I say to the people, my shit is your shit, and that's exactly what you're producing. The only difference is the council's getting rid of it for you.
What's the solution?
We don't have a solution. That's the problem with humanity. We make shit.
Do you think off-grid living is the solution to all of our problems?
No, that's not a solution. It's escaping. That's escaping the problem. We have to start thinking in the future rather than tomorrow or the next day.
After my time on the barrier, it's clear the off-grid life is far from perfect. New arrivals will continue to pose a major dilemma for this unique paradise.
So we're going to see more and more people coming over. So how do we manage that? Yeah.
One thing, you can't expect someone to come in and live sustainably if we don't live sustainably and we're not setting the template for them. So we have to inoculate them and ferment that in them.
To survive its newfound popularity, this tiny island will have to tackle some of the biggest questions of our time.
But we need to think of a whole community when we think of sustainability and how we can collaborate more and work together, because that's really the only way we can solve a lot of these bigger problems.
But catching up with Patrick, there's still a chance for locals to shape its future.
This is my one bit of billboard paraphernalia from when I joined local council. A little hand-painted sign here, and no one had ever done a sign. So I decided, why not? I painted this with like three colours and then hung it on my friend's front fence. And it worked, got us in.
Did you get elected?
Yeah, so I'm elected member now of the local authority. That was local board, 2019. So we're getting through the 3-year term now.
With Patrick's help, the island's future looks resilient, sustainable, and hopefully green.
You got to lead by example and literally do it yourself. Like, you can talk about these things as much as you want, but if you're not leading by example, it's hard for people to follow you.
So you could be the future leader of this island one day.
Oh, look at, yeah, well, you could do.
One project at a time, Patrick.
Yeah, yeah.